MTV Music Video Awards were held, and one local production received two awards from it, Breakthrough Video and Best Special Effects. The film was, videos, of course, Jim Blashfield's Tears for Fears, something sowing the seeds of love. It's also voted as the Rolling Stone, in the Rolling Stone Readers Poll last year, as Best Video of the Year. So we thought it would be appropriate to show it right now. With Jim and producers, Jim Blashfield and Paul Diener, Stan, I'm sure they're here today. Take a bow, please. Let's roll the video.
Thank you. Hey.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome back to day two of the Portland Creative Conference, our celebration of film and television. I thought this morning I'd say a few words and show a couple things myself about what I like to do, why I do what I do. And when I think about it, I think what comes to my mind and intrigues me the most is not necessarily for myself creating projects that are, let's say, a particular subject or a particular theme, but rather, I think my fascination is with bringing things to life. That's not to say that I don't feel like I have a point of view, because everybody does. You have a theme, you know, your sort of life theme that you guides you in making decisions about what you do. But I think that the real fascination for me and for what it is that our company has done in Claymation has to do with this thing of bringing things to life. No, I'm not going to bring the baby out this morning. Movie makers always do this, bring things to life. It sounds like kind of that fascination might sound like kind of a trying to be God syndrome or something. But, in fact, I think that's a fascination that all of us share in one form or another, whether it's coming up with an idea that then gets translated into a script, realized in a script, and then further realized visually and so forth, and finally coming, you know, with the impact and power that film and television can have, coming across to create, to move you, to excite you, to put you on the edge of your seat, to make you cry, to make you sweat, whatever it is. There's an incredible excitement, I think, that drives me in being able to do that kind of thing, to create out of nothing or out of mere ideas something that has that kind of effect on people. Animators have even one step beyond that in terms of bringing things to life. But literally, of course, animators bring stuff, make the inanimate alive. And I think there are a number of elements to, in my mind, that make something live. One of the things is the film style itself. Film style meaning all of the various elements that we have at our disposal. It's the story, the special effects, the sound effects, the lighting techniques, and so on. All of these things contribute to helping us to be able to tell a story. What we've done over the years as film and television has become more sophisticated is develop a kind of vocabulary that we all begin to understand. The vocabulary tells us certain things. We've created conventions through this vocabulary that allows us to do certain things, and those things mean something. When we see those, because we're enculturated with the American film experience, we know what that means. We use that all the time. We use that to make our films, if we want to, more real than they otherwise would be. In other words, we might use a particular cutting technique. It's actually fairly mundane when you think about it, but we use a specific cutting technique that you've seen a dozen times in live-action films before. Subliminally, if you do that with animation, the same sort of cutting technique, it connotes something that you've seen before. You interpret it as the same level of reality that you saw, when you see, say, a live-action film. There's Mr. Bill. Now, there's an interesting character. Mr. Bill is, those of you know who he is, in fact, has no animation to him at all. He's, in spite of what everybody thinks, Mr. Bill has this persona. But in fact, he never moves.
never moves at all. So it's strictly the conventions, in this case, not very sophisticated conventions, but conventions nevertheless of voice, a little bit of other motion, hands or whatever, come in and create some action for Mr. Bill. We all think that somehow Mr. Bill's alive in spite of the fact that he never moves. There's also, in the process of designing, bringing characters to life, animated characters, design and, for me anyway, depth are important elements in that sort of life process. Depth meaning, because we work in a three-dimensional medium, there's already a kind of a natural, the objects that we animate exist, they live, if you will, in real space on tabletop, in a set, whatever. But the design, of course, is an incredibly important element. Design of a character in itself can give a great deal of life and vitality to that character. The comic strips are often a good example of that. The design, sometimes, you know, it's the case of a picture saying 1,000 words. But I think the real crux of the whole thing of life, of course, is motion. That's what we mean almost when we say bringing things to life. And motion or action is, of course, that is the art of the animator. The animator has to know how to communicate much the way a mime does, because that's the tool that you have, the area in which you are working when you try and communicate with animation is in motion. There's a film that I'd like to show you called Luxo Jr. By John Lasseter that I think is just an incredible example of how motion is, how strong an element motion is in terms of the life of a character and of the craft, I think, also of the animator. Luxo Jr. is, John, some of you I'm sure have seen it. John wanted to do a film with basically Luxo lamps, and he did. This film is using two Luxo lamps, although they're computer generated. One Luxo lamp is exactly totally realistic. It never distorts. It never changes. It doesn't have eyes, for sure. It doesn't have nose, mouth, and definitely doesn't have hands and feet and all the other things that we associate with sort of maybe necessary to bringing something to life. He has deviated from that rather strict sort of a thing by creating a second character, Luxo Jr. character. And all he's done, though, is change the dimensions of some of the parts of his Luxo lamp so that they're shorter arm on it and so on. Otherwise, it's just there's two Luxo lamps, if you will. It's a stunning piece of film because I think of I think you'll agree with me, just play it, as to the level of communication that you know about these lamps in spite of the fact that they have no other things, eyes, mouth, and so on. It's remarkable, the level of emotion, almost, I get when I watch a piece of film. I think that is really, in a way, the sort of essence of of the creative act of the animator. So as I said, I think what our company is doing, and we want to continue doing, is exploring the world of Claymation and
and for related, related kinds of ways, with Claymation as kind of the centerpiece of bringing various things to life. So what I'd like to do now is to show you just a very short clips, we call it combo, of some of our productions that actually spans about a 15-year period. Actually, just a few of them, really, but some of the various characters and some of the various situations that we've brought to life. Good. Roll the tape.
Thank you.
So as long as there are things, inanimate things out there, our gang will fight on to bring them to life. I would like to open it to questions. We've got a few minutes before, a couple questions if anybody wants to. I had a few requests earlier, so if somebody wants to, then we'll get on with our next speaker. Yeah. Anybody? Good. Well, let's get on with our next speaker then. okay, where's the question?
When you did the segment with the speed demon, did you do just the claymation, or did you also shoot the time lapse and other things? Was that a
conjunction? We shot all of it. The speed demon sequence of Moonwalker was, except for there's an opening sequence that we shot in various stages in Hollywood, but most of it was all in the nighttime stuff. We shot on the streets of Portland, streets in the river and the surrounding areas. It was done with all the background plates on that were done with a camera running approximately one frame or two frames a second, on a camera car or out in front of hanging from the front of our boat in the case of the water shots. And so we're tracking, going through town at apparently extremely fast speeds like 400 miles an hour, I think it computed out to, or something like that. So most of that, to those background, or almost all of the footage we shot or had control of, that was Portland at night. One of the nice things about shooting a frame a second, of course, is that you have great exposure latitude, and you use just nothing but available light to get plenty of exposure. So it's kind of a nice thing. Anything else? Mm-hmm. I began studying architecture in the University of California and started making movies as an independent. And experimented really initially with all kinds of animation, plus stop motion kinds of things, and then architecture, even cars, drive around building models that we built and stuff like that. Before that, I picked up a camera in the first in about 67 when I was in college, when I first went to college, and it was my dad's equipment, and he had long since given up on it, all the stuff, so he shipped it all off to me, and I sort of took it over and took it on with a vengeance. And I first got acquainted with clay studying in architecture, studying Antonio Gaudí, who was very inspirational. He used very organic kinds of architecture. And then I had did some early experiments, and then years later, after gaining my film skills, doing lighting, directing, and some editing a lot, freelance shooting, directing one ill-fated low-budget feature, and one produced and directed one of my own. I was good to sort of feature on counterculture in those times, which is rather famous. I got together with Bob Gardiner, who was a sculptor, a friend from California College of Arts and Crafts, and he made did some further experiment more professionally at that time with the medium, and made close members, and I've stayed with the clay pretty much since. That's the evolution, yes.
Something that somebody came to you and said, we would like a character such as this, and would you create something for us?
Yeah, actually, you know, it's kind of an interesting case. The Domino's Pizza came and they wanted a mascot of some kind, and Barry Bruce, who's was the Barry, you hear? Barry was sort of head designer on the project, along with Craig Bartlett, Bill Feasterman, and various people that got involved in it. But it was kind of an interesting case because Domino's came to us with some specific ideas about wanting this sort of little gnome type of a character. And he went through quite an evolution of being a little gremlin to little rabbit characters to various kinds of things, and he kind of evolved into what is his current form, which is kind of a camel, in design terms, anyway. But it was quite a long process. I forget if some of you can help me with those. It was about a 6 or 8 month process, and back and forth. That's not usually the way the characters are designed. Usually the advertising agencies come in a little bit more on their side, in terms of suggestions, at least, for a design, rather than just simply a few words. But so Domino, the Noid is actually one of kind of a favorite character because he really designed him with animation in mind, and so often characters aren't designed with that much sort of vision. Anything else? A short question, good. Actually, you might. There's a number of our staff here today, why don't you cut corner them and I'll tell you all about it, perhaps. Real quickly, we have a terrific group of people in a terrific studio. We're in Northwest Portland. What is our clay is this ordinary plasticine clay. We've gone through a variety of, over years of sort of looking at various kinds of clays. And we have a couple different kinds and a lot of tricks that make it softer and harder and so on and so forth. But it's basically just a regular plasticine, meltable plasticine modeling clay. The very first project we did with Claymation was a Rainier beer commercial, was at the same time we did I did mountain music. In fact, the mountain was the same mountain that we erupted in mountain music. It must have been 77. Let's move on with our program. Thank you, and let's move on. Our first speaker this morning.